First Kings, in the 19th chapter, verse 4, it says, "But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers." Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, today as we come to you and as we listen to the word, Lord, I pray that you would minister in this. Lord, that you would give us something that we could grasp and that we could take with us, and that we would, something that we would ponder upon, something that would guide us and direct us, and give us understanding and wisdom, and also a desire to want more of you. We thank you for the people that are here, Lord. Bless them, Lord. Bless the reading of the word. In Jesus' name we pray. We find here, as we begin to look here at 1 Kings, and we begin to see how Elijah was feeling down on himself, so to speak. He just had a face-off with the 450 prophets of Baal, which he won with God's help, as God performed great miracles there. But as he went back, as word got back, and Jezebel, she began she would want his life. She wanted to take his life from him. So he got afraid. After experiencing what God could just do for him, and what God, how God just delivered him and answered prayers and showed the people who God truly was, he became afraid. And he ran. It says he went a day's journey into the wilderness where he was hoping to die. He sat down under the juniper tree, hoping that, he said, "This is enough. I am finished. Just take my life, Lord. I am finished." Basically, what he was doing, he was feeling down for himself, thinking that there was nobody left in this world except for himself to serve God. Later, if you continue to read, you find out God said he had 7,000 other Israelites that he would continue to serve him. And that's what gave him hope, that there were others out there that were going through the same thing as he was, continuing to serve God. God showed him things within the wind and the earth and other things, and showed that he wasn't in them, but he showed us that he would be with him at all times. And then he went on to show him that he said, "I wasn't finished with you." He wanted him to go down to anoint people to be kings over Israel and over Judah. And he also wanted him to anoint people to be prophets. And lots of other things. God wasn't finished with him yet. It says he had to travel almost 40 days to get to where he was going. But can you imagine walking for 40 days? One of the other things that's really not mentioned is when he went, before he left, he sent an angel to feed him twice. The first time, after he was under the juniper tree and he requested to die, it says he fell asleep. And God sent an angel down and made him a king, and he left him a cruse of water in the King James, and it may state differently in other versions, but it says that he left him food there to drink, to strengthen him. He says after he was finished, the word of God says he went back to sleep. And when he awoke again, there was other food there for him. I think it goes on to say that I would presume that it must have been meat of some sort, because he said he would have to last, in so many words, it says he would have to last for 40 days upon this meat that this angel had prepared for him. So he was going to go a long time before he got food again. This is how God works miracles. He takes care of us. He still needs us. My question to you today is, what happened on the way? And that is talking about our spiritual life. What happens to us on the way? And this can be for our regular lives that we work here through each and every day. What happens to us in life? Early this year, we look outside and we begin to see that there were beautiful trees outside that had wonderful leaves on them. But through the process of the seasons, the colors begin to come out. And trees begin to show their true colors that God has given to them. And soon we find as the seasons go on, they lose these leaves and they begin to look at it as if they're dead. In our own walk in life, we are no different somewhat than these trees, especially in our spiritual walk. If we accept Christ as our personal Savior, we fall in love with God. And we shine bright and green and wonderful, beautiful, just like these leaves do. And through the processes of life, we begin to show, so to speak, our true colors that God has given us. So day commitments, it seems today in life that commitments really don't mean anything anymore. We look at marriage, we look at just all kinds of other circumstances that people have made commitments to, and they fail to see the whole truth of these things. We often find ourselves in a state of confusion, not knowing where to go. We don't go forward, we don't go backward, we don't go side to side. We stay exactly where we're at because we're not sure where we need to go. As soon as in our spiritual walk, we slowly, our lights go out. We soon die away from following after God the way that He wants us to. If you take a candle like these candles here this morning, you see their flames as they reach towards heaven. So to speak, giving God the glory, for they're able to burn and to do what they're supposed to do. But if you take the oxygen away from them, slowly they would become smaller. Still reaching to heaven, but surely after a while they would become dim, and then out. And then they'd be no more than just a puff of smoke. Our everyday lives, our spiritual lives are the same way. If we choke off in our spiritual lives, God forbid, if we don't get that continually feeding of God in our lives, we too are going to be like a candle slowly dying out. As a candle needs oxygen, we need God in our lives. And we cannot do it unless we have God in our lives. Today, it seems many people act as like if they're in a club when they go to church. They associate themselves to other people. Why am I in such and such church, and this church, and that church, for what they do? They are a club member in the church. What are you doing today for what really counts? What are you living for today, and how are you living your life is what really counts? Are you being a child of God or a member because you've allowed your life to be carried away from your true first love? I hope and pray that no one ever forgets when they have accepted Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. But He has given you that joy and that hope within you. Because you must have a point where to start from. But my point is, when Elijah ran, God allowed him to go. God allowed him to go so far before He stopped him and said, "This is where I want you to go." And he had to turn around and actually go back to the point where he started from, begin where God wanted him to go. And that's the same way with us. If we follow after Christ, if we slip away, we have to go back once again to the beginning where we were once was. That first love that we fell in love to, we must start over again and begin all over again. For many, we commit and we commit and we commit some more. And sometimes then we commit again. But for what? What do we truly commit to? It seems today we commit ourselves to a lot of things, but we don't follow through with what we committed ourselves to. For many, certainly not marriage, or jobs, or friends, or our love for anything for that matter. And the sad thing is that we're never able to commit until we truly get it right with God. You know you can't fully commit to anything in life. And I would challenge you on this. You cannot fully commit to anything in life unless you have God within you. God is what gives us stability. All we may think, well, I spent years doing this. You don't call that commitment? It is commitment. But it's not the kind of commitment that you can have if God would have been with you. If God would have been living in your life, we could accomplish so much more. We'll never accomplish it without God. God must be the foremost in our lives. The person who goes before us, the one who takes care of us and watches over us. God has to be within our lives, and our breath and our breathing and everything that we do, God must be within our lives. Many and some will say, but wait a minute, I have toys. I have things I like to do in life. I have motorcycles, I have boats, I have money, I do all these things. And these things give me enjoyment in life. And I can go through life with these things. But it's not the same. Saving is putting a blindfold over you, so to speak, if you believe that all these things can give you satisfaction in life. Yes, they may be fun. And all these things may be enjoyable to you, but yes, Satan is pulling forward of our eyes, so to speak. Many people find it hard serving God because it seems like we have to give up so many things that we would enjoy to do. Sleeping in with them, trying to go full riding or going hunting, all these things that we could be doing rather than serving God. considered the game chess before? Some people like to play it, and some people like it. I want you to read scripture before we get into that. Matthew 6, 19 says, lay not of yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust and doth corrupt, where thieves and break through and steal. And as we look at Matthew 6:20, it says, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust nor corrupt, or where the thieves do not break through nor steal. Now look back at chess once again. The game of chess, which I like to play, but it's Satan likes to play that same game as well. And he's much better at it than I am. Perhaps any of us here today, I'm sure. In the game of chess, of course, like all games, the object is to win. And to do it in such a way that your opponent has no idea what's in it. Set up a front one way and get them from behind one another way. And cause them to make a move that will ultimately cost them the whole entire game. And then you will be victorious in the winning. Satan plays this game every day of our lives. He puts things in front of us that causes us to think, man, this is what I want. This is what I find enjoyment in. These are the things that I need to do. And then he gets us from another direction. But really the important thing and the sad thing is that his fate is already set. He already knows his outcome in life. What he is playing with is our own lives. We are playing this life with our own spiritual lives. And once we lose, we are lost. Once it's over, it is finished. Once God sends his time for us to come home, it is over. There will be no more chances to try again. Our game will be over, so to speak. We are playing with our lives. And it's more critical than I think what most people realize. This is you, that you're thinking, that you're living today. The things that you do in life only affect you, so to speak. Yes, they may affect other people by your actions and things, but you're truly only affecting yourself. And this is why it's so critical that we really understand what we are truly playing here on earth. There's not going to be a resetting of the board. I'm going to challenge you again. Once his life is over, it is over. The pieces are going to be knocked off, so to speak, taken away from the board. And as we begin to lose our playing pieces in this game of life, they're not coming back. We have to make sure that God is in the foremost of our lives, and he will protect you and take you and give you a way out to the end. Today it seems like people are only thinking of themselves. And I know many of us can do this. People are only looking out for me, or he's looking out for himself, or so to speak. Always looking for ways to lift themselves up in other people. Sadly to say, it includes many church members throughout this country and out around the whole entire world. Nobody is excluded from this. People are, many times, are only thinking of themselves. Until we get together, how do we expect God to bless us? You know, it's important as a family of God, no matter where we're at or where we're going, that we come together as one. That we come together and we allow God to use us in a way that he's never used us before. It's hard. Have you ever had someone move your arm before? And, you know, it's tough to let all your weight down and allow that person to move your arm because you're wanting to hold it up. You don't know what they're going to do. They're going to jerk it, or they're going to drop it, or they're going to do what? You're trusting that they're going to. They're wanting to say, well, give me your weight. Let me have your arm. Relax. And you're holding it there. And you feel like you left your weight off it, but you quite haven't done that yet. And they're saying, relax. Do it all to me. This is what God is asking for us to do. He's saying, relax. Let me take care of your problems and things in this world. I just want you to give me your all and to me. Quit thinking about yourself, the things that you can gain out of life. Just trust in me. Allow me to be number one in your life. This is what God wants us to do. Throughout the Bible, God blessed those who respect him, honor, and praise him throughout the Bible. All through Scripture, you can see what people were given their time. And they took time to praise God and to build altars and just to glorify God and to give God the credit. God blessed them. God said, for your faithfulness, I'm going to bless you. And many, many accounts throughout the Bible. Put their spiritual lives first and know that 5:16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. You know, we're supposed to share our faults with one another. You know, that's not always easy to do, is it? Not very often we want to go over and knock on our neighbor's door and say, hey, that's what they were wrong with me. But the Bible tells us to do so. The Bible tells us that we're supposed to share with one another our faults, to pray for one another, to exalt one another, to lift each other up. This is what we're here for. Praise and honor God. In Mark 13:34 it says, for the Son of Man is a man making a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work and commandment in order to walk. When Jesus left this world, he gave us all by commandment. It's in your hands now. You are supposed to pick up where I left off. Everything that I did, you're supposed to do. Supposed to teach to other people, minister to other people, care for other people, show my love to other people. God gives a lot, a handful, so to speak, a whole lapful, so to speak, and so it'll be running everywhere. But we are supposed to do what God has asked us to do. In 1849, a wagon train was traveling through the Death Valley and followed the gold rush into California. As this particular wagon train struggled through the Death Valley, the hottest place in California, they looked ahead and saw a sheet of water they all believed was Devil's Lake. But it was just a mirage. Created by the intense heat, the harder they pressed on to the water, the more frustrated they become. The foundation for many people's spiritual journey is no more than this mirage. Some people base their entire spiritual life on illusions. What they think and what they think they see. But asking God, God, direct me. Show me what is really out there in front of me. Show me what you want in my life and where you want me to go. Spend so much time in the hustle and bustle of this world, trying to gain more, trying to achieve things. But yet the harder they work, the more they try to achieve, the more frustrated they become. The more stress they have, the more worries that they have. The more items that they collect, the more things they have to worry about. We need to throw our cares upon God and say, God, show me where you want me to go and where you want me to be. Many people start out with good intentions, but end up frustrated and stuck, never making that goal they had set out to do because they lost their true vision. You know, today we have a lot of people going to college. A lot of young people heading off to college. And they may go to college for 4-6 years of their lives and not accomplish a thing. I know people that went to college, and I work with a couple guys that went to college. I went to school with them, and they said, I went to college for 4 years, and there's people out there living workers making more than I am. You know, so to speak, or managing McDonald's that never went to school making more than I am. She said, what was the point? And life is the same way. Instead of serving God, we get so wrapped up in the things of the world that we forget our true focus. What is important in life? And that's Jesus Christ. I want you to examine our own lives now. We're going to walk with God. I want you to ask yourself, what happened on the way in your walk, in your life? What happened to your spiritual walk? Are you still in the same place where you began when you first accepted Jesus as your personal Savior? Or have you not even begun? I want you to consider that in your mind. Where am I in life? In my mind? Is it something I hope you carry with you all week? I want you to keep asking yourself every day, at least twice a day, what happened on my way? Am I still continuing to go where I started out to be? Some people have a harder journey than others because God knows how much each and every one of us can handle. Some He gives more to and some less. But yet the journey is still the same, no matter how much we have. For each person, the results are still the same. Life is still hard. And the end result is still the same. It doesn't matter what we have in us. Together, we are not alone in this. As we look at Elijah, when God said, I have 7,000 other people still serving me in Israel. That was a lot of people because really there wasn't that many people on earth at that particular time. So 7,000 people is a lot of people. Today, your life this week and ask yourself, what has happened along the way? Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, today as we come to you, Lord, we just pray, Lord, as we ponder this question in our own lives for each and every one of us, and this is a personal question, what has happened to us along the way? Lord, I pray as we think about this week that we would think, well, am I still doing what you've asked me to do? Do I still have the same vision in mind? Am I still focused upon you? Am I still serving you the way that you have me to? Or has anything changed in my life? Or am I closer to you? Or am I walking in a different way than you have to do? I think this is an important question. Lord, I pray that you would minister to those this week. Lord, I pray that you would bless the people that are here in their walk, Lord. That you would stretch us and give us a desire to want to grow more and more for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I ask that our song would come. Bad things may seem to be about us. Good morning and welcome to our Sunday School Hour. This morning we have a birthday song, and then I have a little reading for you that I think is something we haven't heard for a while. First, Emily, would you lead us in our birthday song? If you've had a birthday, come and share as we sing. Has just begun. Dear members of the Oakdale Church, the flowers you sent for Bruce's funeral were lovely. Thank you for your thoughtfulness. May all of you be blessed for the kindness you have shown us. Respectfully, Icky and Mary Kay and the family of Bruce Heyer, Sr. Another card. Save the date for the wedding. Emily and Matt, July 7th, 2012. This is to the Oakdale Church. It'll be on the refrigerator, bulletin board, or something. So, church is reminded this is kind of one of those save the date things for their wedding coming up in July. A couple things that I'll announce only because the people are absent that need to collect them. Today is the deadline to get your name to Elaine for the Veterans Day balloons.
She said give them to me, but I'm not going to be here for months, so I don't know
who. Emily, you're going to be seeing Elaine later in the day. Get your names, if you have any, to Emily for the Veterans Day balloons. And that's just a thought I wanted to keep with you. Shoebox is coming up on the 13th of November. And there was another one in here for Pat. If you know any ladies to invite to Advent the Candlelight, please give their names and address to Patty today. None of them being here, I would say that you might want to give Patty a call. Or maybe Diana can get them to Patty. She's been working with her on the invitations for the Advent by Candlelight. So get a Diana or give Patty a call if you need to get those names and haven't done it already. Are there any other announcements that need to be made?
The harvest party that was scheduled has been rescheduled for November the 5th at 6:30.
November the 5th, 6:30. Oh, thank you so much. November the 5th at 10 o'clock, the men are gathering here to clean down the front of the church and clean some gutters out. We had a little meeting this morning, and we appreciate the men that said they could make it on that day. Also, I think Jared's going to stop by and check out the oldest generator. We talked about that problem in the men's meeting this morning and get that going before winter because it wasn't working before. If you know of other needs in the community, the men discussed it this morning, please get those needs to Pastor Mike, and we will, I'm sure, bring it to the men's group for our consideration of getting people ready for winter and just any needs around the community. We want to address those. This is our outreach of our church needs to be to our communities. Pastor, do you have anything to say additionally to that?
I would like to add a little bit more on that, Thanksgiving meals will be coming up. I would like to try to get at least 5 families or so within the community. If you know someone that is maybe in need of a meal or something for Thanksgiving that maybe cannot do that, I appreciate you giving that name to me.
So you're seeking people that would be in need in our community to help him. It's great to reach out like that to them. Anything else? Any other announcements? I'll just make a comment. Our projection system that we worked on yesterday getting installed, to the point that it is, we're finding that there's some things that we need to add. We thought we would probably need a screen. Obviously, we're going to need a screen because it's skewed. your bulletin right at the bottom of the announcements. Just go to the website and then click on that area of the webpage that will guide you to the, today's sermon, and you will be able to see and hear the sermon. Any questions about that? We do thank Matt for all his efforts, continued efforts to get this thing going. And if you ever have to go in that attic, make one trip to it. Because it is no fun going from there to here on that little space up there above the high challenge. But anyway, we had some fun putting it in, and Matt's done a lot of work to get this thing set up. Any questions about our new system? Any questions about it? Well, if you've got individual questions, you might see Matt. Additional announcements. How about cards?